Well, it's 3:30, and now here on BBC Radio 3, the third in the classical guitar series presented by John Williams, Guitar Notes.
Today I'm going to be looking at English guitar music. When I first came to England from Australia as a boy of 11, my parents took me up to North London to hear a concert given by an amateur orchestra, and the soloist in the Rodrigo Concerto for guitar was Julian Bream. Julian then must have been about 19 or 20. But now when I look back at not just the friendship with Julian Bream, but listening to his wonderful playing over the years, I can remember during the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, every concert he gave in London, there was some new piece of music by a famous English composer. So let's begin with one of those pieces inspired by Julian Bream and his playing, a set of 5 bagatelles by Sir William Walton, the last one, number 5. That was the last of the 5 bagatelles by Sir William Walton, written for Julian Bream and played by him. Probably the most well-known piece associated with Julian Bream is Benjamin Britten's Nocturnal. This combined, in a way, 2 interests shared by both Benjamin Britten and Julian Bream. Julian used to play the lute almost as much as the guitar at one stage, and he had a particular affinity with all the English lute repertoire, John Dowland and others. And in the case of Benjamin Britten, who also knew and loved that music, he was fascinated in all his work with the subjects of sleep and dreams. And a particular song of John Dowland, Come Heavy Sleep, was chosen as the idea for this piece. The form of it is that it opens with a fairly freely improvised style introduction and a sequence of divisions or variations in different and very interesting technical and musical styles until the whole piece, as it were, descends or draws towards its close with a version of the original song. So here is the Passacaglia, which gradually evolves into that beautiful song, Come Heavy Sleep. Thank you. The last part of Benjamin Britten's Nocturnal After John Dowland, played by Julian Bream. There are many other composers who have written music for Julian Bream, but one of the composers that I first heard Julian playing back in the 1950s is Stephen Dodgson. He's written widely for the guitar, not just solo guitar, but two guitar concertos, guitar and cello, guitar ensemble, guitar and voice, trios, quartets, etc. It's just the same language musically that he uses when he's writing for string quartet or solo piano or harpsichord. But he has this unique affinity for qualities of the guitar which are often, I think, forgotten by other composers, especially the rhythmical quality of the guitar. The sense of silence you get between notes, even when you're playing a very rhythmical piece, not necessarily a quiet or an intimate piece. That was the first variation, or division, as it's called, from a piece by Stephen Dodgson called Fantasy Divisions. As I mentioned before, Stephen Dodgson has written a number of pieces for different guitar ensembles. River Song is a lovely duet for two guitars, and it's been issued on a recent CD in a collection of Stephen Dodgson's guitar music and played by Mark Eden and Chris Stell, the Eden-Stell duo. The Eden-Stell duo playing part of River Song by Stephen Dodgson. Two of the big technological advances which have helped the guitar in the last 50 years or so has been, first of all, the advent of nylon strings. Before that, guitarists were playing on gut strings, which, especially in hot weather and tropical climates, used to fray on the frets and wear out and go out of tune, and it was quite a nightmare, sometimes apparently having to change strings every sort of half an hour or hour. But with the arrival of nylon strings in the 1940s, all these problems were solved, because nylon strings can last anything up to a year or two. The other big advance for the guitar has been the development of amplification, and in particular, in the last 20 or 30 years, very good quality amplification. And this has meant that the guitar could be fully incorporated into what we like to call normal music making, normal concert giving, and all those circumstances of recording and performances that are essential to any performer on an instrument these days. A particular example of this, which was an enormous, not just pleasure, but an eye-opening experience for me, was to take part in a magnificent work called Plague in the Moonflower, a joint composition, the music by Richard Harvey, and the words by Ralph Steadman. In fact, words and images, because the performances of this piece include the projection of wonderful paintings by Ralph Steadman and 20 to 30 foot diameter screens above the orchestra. Now, we gave the first performance of this piece in Exeter Cathedral, and other performances followed in St. Paul's Cathedral and Canterbury Cathedral. And the guitar is an important element of the ensemble. It has solos throughout. But it also, this work has a choir, a boys' choir, a boys' soprano, large percussion department, and a very, very large-scale piece where the guitar, because of the amplification, can contribute its unique qualities. Let's listen to the opening as an example of this, the Entrada, which is a massive, big, almost medieval orchestral opening, conjuring up all sorts of timeless images in which the guitar joins afterwards. Part of the opening entrada to Plague and the Moonflower, which is a wonderful large-scale eco-oratorio by Richard Harvey and Ralph Steadman. Film music is an area where the guitar has increasingly been featured in the last 20 or 30 years. My first collaboration with Stanley Myers was on a film about 1970. And after that, we found that so successful that we decided to make a record together of different arrangements, some of Stanley Myers' own original tunes and also some arrangements of other standard tunes. I remember in a restaurant in South Kensington trying to think of tunes for the next day that we were going to record, and Stanley Myers sitting at the piano running through lots of little melodies, and he suddenly came across one which sort of went a bit like this. I said to him, "What's that?" And he said, "Well, that's a tune I wrote about 2 years ago for a film called The Walking Stick, an English film set in London's Docklands." And I said, "But that's fantastic. Can't you make a real piece of music about it? In other words, something that can be played as an instrumental on a record, nothing to do with the film." Anyway, cut a long story short, he did do that and called the piece Cavatina. And it was only about 5 years, 6 years later that the producer and director of a film called The Deer Hunter, Michael Cimino, who had been given our record by his assistant producers for his birthday, had hit upon that tune and decided that it was the perfect tune for the film of The Deer Hunter. And of course, that's how it became better known. Unusual in the sense that, first of all, it was already used for another film years before, and that it was a piece of music that already existed. It wasn't commissioned especially for the film, although of course we re-recorded it and did all the other bits that you do with film music afterwards. Thank you. That was a part of Cavatina, also known as the theme from The Deer Hunter, by Stanley Myers. A composer who epitomises most of the things we've been talking about in today's programme is Malcolm Arnold. He wrote over 80 film scores, but his most well-known guitar piece is his Guitar Concerto. So I'd like to end today's programme with Julian Bream playing the last movement from Malcolm Arnold's Guitar Concerto. The last movement from Malcolm Arnold's Guitar Concerto, played by Julian Bream with the Melas Ensemble and conducted by Malcolm Arnold himself, In the next programme, we're going to look at Latin America and the combination of popular music with the classical instrument.
Guitar Notes with John Williams was produced for BBC Radio 3 by Alan Shipton for Unique, the production company.